You down with OPP? I'm talking about oral platelet pills. Get your mind out of the gutter.
Army with harmony.
Hi guys, welcome back. We're here on location at the side of my house. There's two reasons for this. Number one, it's my day off and I really don't want to go back to the cath lab to film this. Number two, my kids have totally outrun the house and this is the quietest place I can find to talk about today's subject. So today's subject, we are talking about our oral antiplatelets. So I got my notes here and we'll get started. Now, basically I want to talk about three medications. First one's aspirin, then clopidogrel, which is better known as Plavix, and then ticagelor, which you know as Brilinta. So let's talk about what are antiplatelets first. So first of all, what do? Number one, they inhibit platelet aggregation. So they act upon the platelet cell itself to prevent the aggregation or stickiness of the platelets together to form clots. Now, number one, you gotta remember, this is an irreversible process for these drugs. That's why you don't see that there's any antidote, like giving vitamin K for warfarin or FFP for other anticoagulants, okay? Because this irreversibly affects the platelets. So the only thing that really reverses it is either you give a platelet transfusions or time, where the platelets will regenerate itself to get rid of the affected platelets. Now remember, these drugs are not anticoagulants, they're antiplatelets. Anticoagulants affect the coagulation pathway by affecting factors outside the actual aggregation process of the platelets itself. So it could affect factor 8, factor 5, or Lovenox, which affects factor 10A. So it affects processes outside of the actual aggregation pathway. Now, one thing we won't be talking about are IV antiplatelet drugs. These are integrilin and riopril. And we'll talk about why don't you see them much anymore too. Now, with each drug, I want to talk about briefly about its mechanism, loading dose, maintenance of dose, and then management and other side effects, okay? So let's get started. Okay, so let's talk about the first drug, which is the venerable aspirin. Now, aspirin inhibits platelet aggregation by inhibiting cyclooxygenase 1 and 2, or COX 1 and 2 for short. As far as the loading dose that we use 325 milligrams. Now, typically in the ER, the way you would do this, or even on the floor, is to give the patient 4 81 milligram tablets, non-coated. They have to chew it up, swallow it. If they do it that way, it gets absorbed at peak absorption in 1 to 2 hours. So it's relatively fast and it absorbs in the gut really well too, including the rectum. Now, maintenance dose is usually 325 milligrams a day or 81 milligrams a day. Typically these days, I generally recommend doing 81 milligrams daily over the long term because it has the same efficacy as far as its function as an antiplatelet with less likelihood of gastritis and other GI type disturbances. Now, as far as how long do we hold these drugs, or at least hold aspirin in preparation of surgery, if the surgeon asks for it, typically range for anywhere from 5 to 12 days. Now you say, well, why such a wide range? If you think about it, the average platelet lifespan is 7 to 10 days and it's always constantly regenerating itself. So ideally, if you really wanted no antiplatelet effects on this in the body at all, let's say you're going for some kind of neurological or spine surgery, you need to hold it 14 days to make sure that it's absolutely out of the body. By that time, your affected platelets has been consumed up and you've produced new replacements for it. So that's why you see a wide range. But for most people, if you hold 5 days, the body has a chance to reproduce enough of the platelets, so the effects of the aspirin is minimized. Okay, the next drug we're going to talk about is clopidogrel, or more commonly known as Plavix. Now, this drug inhibits platelet aggregation by blocking the P2Y12 component of the platelet aggregation pathway. So it's different from aspirin, but it tries to do the same job, but it is much more aggressive at doing it than aspirin. Now, the typical loading dose is 600 milligrams daily, or correction, 600 milligrams once. Now, how fast does this act to inhibit platelet aggregation? With that 600 milligram bolus, you can expect 30 to 35% inhibition of the platelet aggregation within 6 hours. So that's not so great, but at that time it's the best we had. Now, maintenance dose is 75 milligrams daily. There's no other dose for it. If you see the patient doing 150 milligrams daily, or 75 milligrams twice a day, that's inappropriate. It's supposed to be 75 milligrams daily, and that's it. Now, as far as going back to the bolus, sometimes we used to give 300 milligram bolus. That would be okay, but it's even much slower than the 600 milligram bolus is getting platelet inhibition. So unless you have plenty of time, I would just recommend doing the 600 milligram bolus. Again, how long do we need to hold this in preparation for surgery? The same range, 5 to 14 days. Again, what you're waiting for is new platelets to be made and the affected platelets to be consumed up naturally. Okay, a couple of things that we ought to know about Plavix. Number one, it is generic. So it's still useful in this day and age of using with stenting. So it's still a common staple antiplatelet that we use all the time. It is generic, so remember that. It used to be very expensive and burdensome for a lot of patients. Number two, it has a couple of interactions, but the most common one you might run into is omeprazole, which is Prilosec, can affect this absorption and functionality. Now, this is a small risk in general, but you will see it in labels, or the pharmacy will call on the patients if they see that they're both on omeprazole, which is Prilosec, and clopidogrel. Now, other proton pump inhibitors like Nexium and Protonix, they have much less of effect. So in general, if you have the choice of acid reflux medications and they're on Plavix, you can try to choose Protonix or Nexium. But of course, omeprazole is absolutely the cheapest choice between proton pump inhibitors. So that could be an issue for the patient with cost. Lastly, you gotta remember, surgeons hate Plavix. It is an effective antiplatelet. The problem with that in setting a surgery, wounds will ooze like crazy if the patient is on full dose Plavix and is still effective. If you've ever seen placing IVs or just doing needle sticks on patients who are on Plavix, they do ooze a lot from those puncture site sticks with the needles. So you can appreciate how it would affect the surgical wound. So if a patient's going on a surgery, you gotta remember if they're on Plavix, how long they've been off it, or are they still on it, and be cognizant of that risk. Before we go and talk about Brilinta, which is the next drug, let's take a look at this pie graph. One bourbon, one scotch, one beer. Okay, we're down to our last medication, or our last antiplatelet drug for today, and that is ticagelor, or we know it more commonly as Brilinta. Now, its mechanism of action is the same thing as Plavix. It blocks P2Y12 component of the platelet aggregation pathway. Now, its loading dose is 100 milligrams orally once, and its maintenance dose is 90 milligrams twice a day. except for a minor variation where you would use 60 milligrams twice a day. Its maintenance dose, again, was 90 milligrams twice a day. I mean, mistake the first time, it's twice a day. Now, a quick comment. Typically, with all patients that we give a stent to, they should be on dual antiplatelet therapy. So it's basically aspirin and either Plavix or Brilinta. In Brilinta, it is important that the aspirin dose is 81 milligrams daily, not 325 milligrams daily. Folks who are taking 325 milligrams daily has a higher incidence of bleeding. So 81 milligrams daily in conjunction with Brilinta, 90 milligrams twice a day. Okay, let's talk about the mechanism of Brilinta and how well it works compared to Plavix. Remember when you load a patient up with 600 milligrams of Plavix, it will achieve 30-35% platelet inhibition in 6 hours. With Brilinta, when you load it with 180 milligrams, the patient will achieve 41% platelet inhibition in 30 minutes and nearly 88% platelet inhibition within 2 hours. So it's very, very fast acting. So what are the big advantages to this? Number one, we have a better outcomes after stents. Because Brilinta works so fast, that's why you don't see cardiologists using Rheopril and Targolin anymore. Back in the day when we had Plavix, because Plavix is so slow in inhibiting platelet aggregation, we had to rely on Integrilin and Rheopril to get that action quickly. But with advent of Brilinta, you hardly ever see those patients coming up the ICU on those drips. So it's important when a patient comes in with acute coronary syndrome or STEMI, we tell the ER just to go load them up with 180 milligrams of Brilinta right away, because of that effect. Okay, let's talk about side effects of Brilinta. The most common side effect that we see is shortness of breath. It occurs in about 14% of patients. After loading the bolus of it and starting the medication, they'll complain of wheezing, COPD-like symptoms, and it's a new phenomenon for them where they never had before. So, of course, you worry about, you know, if it's acute coronary issue, but for the most part of the suspicion should be drug side effect. Now, another big side effect or concern we have is cost. Brilinta is a brand name drug, so it can be cost prohibitive for a lot of folks. However, the company that make Brilinta do have some subsidies to that supports the payment of the drug for the patient. On each of the wards, even in cath lab, if you can't find it, there we have these copay cards, and also they also provide for 30-day free voucher cards for the patients. So if you're getting ready to discharge the patient home, make sure they at least have the 30-day free card, and in combination of the subsidy copay card, that could really help them out a lot regarding maintaining the medications and cutting back on their financial burden. Now, the last side effects, of course, the same as Plavix. The surgeons really hate Brilinta, and it is even a more powerful antiplatelet than Plavix. So thus, it's important that they need to hold it off for at least 5 days prior to any kind of major surgeries. So if the patient's undergoing coronary bypass surgery and they're already on Brilinta, most surgeons will insist on holding it for 5 days before operation, because it could cause significant bleeding perioperatively. Okay, one drug that we don't use a lot or see a lot, but it's still, it came out the same time as Brilinta, is Effient. So typically we bolus a patient 20 milligrams of Effient with a daily maintenance dose of 10 milligrams a day. There are three big reasons that we don't use it as regularly as we should. Number one is contraindicated in patients who've had a prior stroke or TIA, because it does increase bleeding risk. So when you see that history, the patient should not be on FEN or, because of increased intracranial hemorrhage long term. Another relative counterindications are patients who are over 75 years of age. They increase bleeding in that population. And also patients who weigh less than 60 kilograms also increase bleeding in that population. Because of these various restrictions that apply for a lot of our patients, a lot of cardiologists these days don't think about FEN first as a first choice line drug. Okay, almost done. Let's talk about miscellaneous things about these antiplatelets. A common question I get is, can we use them with anticoagulants and what should be appropriate dose? Now we're talking about anticoagulation, we're talking about warfarin, Eliquis, Xarelto, those type of anticoagulants, oral anticoagulants. Now, in the setting of a patient who needs long-term anticoagulation, let's say they have atrial fibrillation, and then they get a stent, what is generally the consensus of dosing them with antiplatelets and their anticoagulants? Let's just say the patient's on Eliquis, for example, and they get stented. In Europe, the recommendation is them to continue on the Eliquis, but they only take the one antiplatelet, Brilinta, for example, and eschew the aspirin. This also applies to Eliquis and Plavix, and it's one of the considerations you should make with warfarin, Brilinta, and holding off on the aspirin. Now, even though this is a recommendation with the Cardiology Society in Europe, it hasn't been set in the United States yet. But I think in the future, the trend will move towards that practice long term. But something you would think about when you see a patient on a ward, man, they're on two antiplatelets plus an anticoagulation. Those guys are at a higher risk of bleeding. You should talk about the cardiologist if that's appropriate thing in their judgment. Another question I do get is, should we dose the patient prior to cath? And the answer is yes, because if we stent them, we give that drug anyways. When you do outpatient cath, they're already on it. Holding the dose for morning will not stop the antiplatelet effect, so you're not missing anything. But missing the dose itself in a setting of stent, that can lead more trouble. So definitely, they're already on aspirin and Plavix, for example, just give them the dose prior to your cath. And lastly, one thing you should always think about, if you're on a monitored floor at Deer Valley, most likely the patient has some kind of cardiac history. And you look down on the patient's MAR, and if they're not on any antiplatelets, you have to ask yourself why. If they're not even on an aspirin, you have to ask yourself why. Because if they're missing these medications, they could easily leave home without them and could lead to catastrophe. So you always have to ask, not why you're on it or why not you're on it, is another important question when looking at these patients. Okay, that's it. I hope this was helpful. And if you have any questions, just catch me in the hallway and just ask me. You guys have a good time. Bye. Get out with-